Good morning and welcome to worship on this hot, steamy summer Sunday morning. Glad you've come to worship with us. We had a little scare around here. The power went out about 8:30 this morning. We're up at the manse, and of course we're on the same wire that the church is on. So we're out, church is out, Craig called, we panicked, we thought, uh-oh. It stayed off for about 45 minutes. We weren't sure if we were going to have to put out an emergency email to the organ doesn't work, the air conditioning doesn't work, and all of that. But it came back on about 9:15, and so we're good to go. So we'll hope it stays on. Some of it said there's a truck out there working on stuff, so hopefully they got it taken care of. But we're glad the air conditioning came back on, and we're good to go here on this Sunday morning. It's been so hot, they've been canceling some things. Katie thinks we're wimps around here. She grew up in Texas, West Texas, you know, and this is nothing. but in Texas, you cancel if there's an inch of snow, so it's the same thing. I was going to encourage you to take the friendship pads and register your attendance, but I see all familiar faces here today, so you don't need to worry about that today. But we're continuing to work through our Summer Sunday School Sermon Series. This is the last of that particular series. Ken Godshall will be in the pulpit next week, and he will be preaching some fine sermons for you from the lectionary. But we'd pick it up on the story of Jonah and the whale, a great story from the Bible that we learn as kids, and then we kind of forget about it, but some really good lessons from that story from the Old Testament. Well, let us prepare our hearts now to worship God together. At the sound of the bells, please stand and be prepared to join in our call to worship. The word of God came to Jonah. Go, speak, love, forgive, receive, overflowing from the fullness of God. Thank you. Please remain standing as together we share our need for God's grace as we acknowledge our confession of sin, first in unison and then pausing for a moment of silent and personal prayer, this prayer based on Jonah's repentance before God. Let us pray together. Holy fountain of forgiveness, the tale of Jonah reminds us of your never-ending love for all creation. May we be like the people of Nineveh, who were able to acknowledge their sin and open their eyes to your healing presence. Though you stand ready to forgive our sin, we find it easier to bite our tongues, clench our fists, and cling to our hurts and resentments rather than let you open our hearts. Holy One, we trust you and pour out our hearts to you. Receive the pain that lurks in our humanity as we offer up what we have hidden from ourselves and from the world, those words and deeds that keep us separated from your love. Amen. Friends, we have good news to share with one another this Lord's Day. Some beautiful lines for that hymn we just sang, ransomed, healed, restored, forgiven. Alleluia, alleluia. Praise with us the God of grace. Friends, believe the good news of the gospel. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Amen. May the peace of Christ be with you. Thank you. Gracious God, we praise you this day for your majesty and the beauty of your creation. In the summer season, may we take time to enjoy the mountains, the forests, the rivers, and the seas, and may we renew our commitment to care for the planet you have entrusted to us. Forgive us for our neglect of our responsibility to be good stewards of the earth. As we look around, we see the earth is overheating. It has a fever. People are suffering, especially the poor and the elderly. Help us to reach out to those around us, family, friends, and neighbor, to check and ensure their safety. We pray this day for those who are sick in hospital or recovering from surgery. We pray especially for Linda Lewis, whose surgery was successful, and for that we give you thanks. We ask your continued healing touch upon her in body and spirit. We thank you for the new life and the birth of babies. We ask your blessing on little Mary Ann, grandchild of Ken and Sue Godshall, and little Cassia, born to Will and Amanda Cosnett. Help us to be a church that takes seriously our vow to nurture the next generation in the faith and in love for you and for neighbor. We pray all these things in the name of the one who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Good morning.
Morning.
Our first scripture reading comes to us today from the book of Jonah, chapter 1, verses 1 to 6, 11 through 17. Now the word of the Lord came to Jonah, son of Amittai, saying, "Go at once to Nineveh, that great city, and cry out against it, for their wickedness has come up before me." But Jonah set out to flee to Tarshish from the presence of the Lord. He went down to Joppa and found a ship going to Tarshish. So he paid his fare and went on board to go with them to Tarshish, away from the presence of the Lord. But the Lord hurled a great wind upon the sea, and such a mighty storm came upon the sea that the ship threatened to break up. Then the mariners were afraid, and each cried to his God. They threw the cargo that was in the ship into the sea to lighten it for them. Jonah, meanwhile, had gone down into the hold of the ship and had lain down and was fast asleep. The captain came and said to him, "What are you doing sound asleep? Get up, call on your God. Perhaps the God will spare us a thought so that we do not perish." Then they said to him, "What shall we do to you that the sea may quieten down for us?" For the sea was growing more and more tempestuous. He said to them, "Pick me up and throw me into the sea. Then the sea will quieten down for you. For I know it is because of me that the great storm has come upon you." Nevertheless, the men rowed hard to bring the ship back to land. But they could not, for the sea grew more and more stormy against them. Then they cried out to the Lord, "Please, O Lord, we pray, do not let us perish on account of this man's life. Do not make us guilty of innocent blood. For you, O Lord, have done as it pleased you." So they picked Jonah up and threw him into the sea, and the sea ceased from its raging. Then the men feared the Lord even more, and they offered a sacrifice to the Lord and made vows. But the Lord provided a large fish to swallow up Jonah, and Jonah was in the belly of the fish for 3 days and three nights. This is the word of the Lord.
Our reading continues, our second reading continues the story of Jonah, as we have done this so much, you know, involved in these stories, we need to use both readings to get the whole story across. And chapter two is a psalm, if you will, a prayer of Jonah while he's inside the whale. And then chapter three is what happens next. So listen to the word of God according to Jonah. The word of the Lord came to Jonah a second time, saying, "Get up, go to Nineveh, that great city, and proclaim to it the message that I tell you." So Jonah set out and went to Nineveh, according to the word of the Lord. Now Nineveh was an exceedingly large city, a 3 days walk across. Jonah began to go into the city, going a day's walk, and he cried out, 40 days more, and Nineveh shall be overthrown." And the people of Nineveh believed God, and they proclaimed a fast, and everyone, great and small, put on sackcloth. When the news reached the king of Nineveh, he rose from his throne, removed his robe, covered himself with sackcloth, and sat in ashes. Then he had a proclamation made in Nineveh, "By the decree of the king and his nobles, no human being or animal, no herd or flock shall taste anything. They shall not feed, nor shall they drink water. Human beings and animals shall be covered with sackcloth, and they shall cry mightily to God. All shall turn from their evil ways and from the violence that is in their hands. Who knows? God may relent and change his mind. He may turn from his fierce anger, so that we do not perish." And God saw what they did, how they turned from their evil ways. God changed his mind about the calamity that he said he would bring upon them, and he did not do it. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts together be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Call me Ishmael. Those three words are the famous first line of Herman Melville's Moby Dick. It's an epic book that some have called the greatest American novel. It is, of course, the story told through Ishmael of Captain Ahab, who was obsessed with getting revenge against the great white whale who had cost him a leg on his previous encounter at sea. I must confess at the outset that I have not read Moby Dick. It was not on our reading list in Canadian high schools like it is in many American schools. How many of you have read Moby Dick, or at least think you did somewhere in the past? Well, you can fact check the illustrations I take from the book. When I realized Jonah and the whale was going to be the Bible story for this Sunday, I immediately thought of Moby Dick. In recent years, I've listened to a lot of lectures and podcasts by a writer from Nantucket by the name of Nathaniel Philbrick. Have many of you heard of him or any of his books? Yeah, he's great, great historian. He writes about American history and especially about the whale industry that was centered on his beloved Nantucket Island. He wrote a book about the disaster of the whaling ship, the Essex, which served as somewhat as a model for Moby Dick. And that book was made into a movie by Ron Howard called In the Heart of the Sea. It was not a commercial success, but then again, neither was Moby Dick during Melville's lifetime. It wasn't until after the major calamity of World War I that the book gained a wide audience for its insight into the struggle of good and evil and the relationship between God and humanity. Ishmael is the narrator of the story, and he's the only survivor of their epic encounter with the whale. He's based on the character of Jonah in subtle and not so subtle ways. Early in Moby Dick, Ishmael hears a sermon on the story of Jonah. It was about the importance of listening to God's call, and guess what the name Ishmael means in Hebrew? It means God hears, or more likely, he hears God. Jonah refused to hear God at first and then had his terrifying encounter with the whale, after which he prayed and God heard him, and then he finally heard God's call. Jonah and the whale is another in our top 10 stories from the Old Testament. It's a fantastic story that has entertained kids and adults alike. I remember as a kid seeing many cartoons of people ending up inside a whale's mouth. There's usually a large uvula hanging in the background as the characters light a match to characters ranging from Bugs Bunny to Homer Simpson light a match to try and figure out how to escape. The story is epic because it draws on some of our deepest and darkest fears, doesn't it? Throughout history, humanity has lived in fear of wild beasts, and the whale, well, that's the largest of them all. And the sea, the sea is also a source of both fascination and fear. I'm sure a sunset over the ocean in ancient times was just as beautiful then as it is now, but to head out on the ocean in those days before our modern technology, that must have been terrifying. Images of a storm at sea are about as frightening as you can imagine. Remember that great scene from Forrest Gump where Lieutenant Dan was up in the crow's nest of his ship, shaking his fist at God, yelling, "Is that the best you can do?" And when the storm passed, Lieutenant Dan had finally made his peace with God. That's the depth of the mythology and symbolism that the story of Jonah reaches into. It's a story about a man and his God, but it is also a story about the sea and its dangers. The sea continues to be a dangerous place, doesn't it? I don't think I'll ever get Elizabeth on an ocean cruise. The thought of not seeing land is just too scary for her. I might be able to get her to take one of those river cruises someday because she knows she could swim to shore if she had to. The ocean is beautiful, but it can be dangerous, can't it? The beaches on Long Island are closed this weekend after several shark sightings and attacks. And by coincidence, Shark Week on the Discovery Channel starts today, so Stephen's ready for Shark Week. I've never watched those Shark Week shows, and I never even watched Jaws when it came out. That's just too frightening for me, But as terrifying as a shark attack would be, I think being swallowed by a whale would be even worse. And as wild as impossible as it sounds, a Cape Cod man was swallowed by a whale last year, and he lived to tell the story. His name is Michael Packard, and on several media outlets, he described what it was like to be inside a whale's mouth for 30 or 40 seconds. Of course, reporters couldn't resist making the comparison to Jonah. Jonah is one of the 12 minor prophets of the Hebrew Bible. It's a small book with only four chapters. We read virtually half of it today. It's a story filled with some very strange imagery and some theology we find difficult to deal with. The picture of God in the book is one of an angry and capricious God. God wants to punish people for sin, but God can also be convinced to forgive. There are many levels of meaning to explore in the book, but the main lesson is one of answering the call. God calls, and we sometimes want to ignore and distract and even run in the opposite direction. And when we do, things do not go well for us, just as they didn't go well for Jonah. The story begins with the sentence, "The word of the Lord came to Jonah." God wanted Jonah to go to Nineveh to preach against them because of their sinfulness. And Jonah did not even pretend to listen. It says he headed straight for the port city of Joppa, which is modern-day Tel Aviv on the Mediterranean coast. And he caught a ship going in exactly the opposite direction. When he tried to run away, he really meant it. He caught a ship headed for Tarshish, which is near Beirut, whereas Nineveh is a landlocked, was a landlocked city near the modern-day Mosul on the Tigris River. It would be a difficult overland journey, so Jonah was not only headed in the wrong direction, he was taking the easy way out, or so he thought. Not long into the story, a storm came up. The sailors knew Jonah to be a religious man, so they asked him to pray. But Jonah knew where the storm was coming from, and he told them they better just sacrifice him to the sea. He knew God was angry with him for running from his calling. And by the way, there are some echoes of the story of Jonah in the New Testament, the Gospels, aren't there? Jonah was asleep during the storm when the captain came to wake him, just as Jesus was asleep on the boat with his disciples during a storm. And the Apostle Paul was caught in a storm in the book of Acts, and the sailors in that story were also throwing everything overboard, and it seemed they were doomed. But in that story, Paul was confident that God would deliver them, and they were shipwrecked on the island of Malta. To this day, Malta has statues to the Apostle Paul and his stay on their island. The sailors didn't want to throw Jonah overboard, but they finally took his advice and did so, and where he was swallowed up by, the Bible says, simply a giant fish that we imagine as a whale. The second chapter of the book of Jonah is a long prayer of Jonah from inside the whale. It reads like a psalm, and it ends with the whale spitting him out on dry land. Then in chapter 3, which begins with the same words as chapter 1, the word of the Lord came to Jonah. So now the second time, Jonah repents and is willing to go to Nineveh. And when he does, the people repent of their evil ways and God spares them. It seems like a happy ending, but in chapter 4, we read that Jonah is actually upset that God was so easily persuaded to forgive. He felt that the people of Nineveh should have to work harder for forgiveness than that. After all, he had to get swallowed by a whale before he was persuaded to repent. So the story of Jonah is a story about repentance. Jonah repented and the people of Nineveh repented. It's interesting to note that the word repent means literally to turn around. It means you're going in the wrong direction and you need to repent and turn around and go the other way. Jonah was literally headed in the wrong direction. He was going by sea to Tarshish when God wanted him to go over land to Nineveh. Jonah repented after his near-death experience, and the people of Nineveh repented when they heard the word of the Lord in Jonah's preaching. The story of Jonah is about repentance, and it is about listening. Jonah finally repented after he heard the word of the Lord that came to him. The first time he heard the word, he ignored it and ran away. The people of Nineveh heard the word, and they repented. The story of Jonah is a story about listening to God's voice and God's call. Listening and repentance. Hearing God's voice and changing direction. That's the takeaway from this story for you and me. God is calling you and me just as God called Jonah. God wants us to turn around and live the way God intends for us to live. We may not be sinning in dramatic ways, but each of us is resisting God's call in subtle and not so subtle ways. God may not be calling us to preach to the people of Nineveh, but God is calling us to love and serve the people in need around us. God is calling us to live according to a different set of values than the world does. God is calling us to be the beloved community that loves God with all our heart, soul, strength, and mind, and our neighbor as ourself. That's a pretty high standard, and one that we can never completely measure up to. So there is always room for repentance. There's always the need to listen more intently for God's call. We may think we have it all figured out, but God often has a surprise in store for us when we take time to listen. A little later during this summer Sunday school series, there comes the story of Samuel and God's call on him when he was just a boy. He was living in the temple as a disciple of Eli, the priest. When he heard God call his name in the night, "Samuel, Samuel," 3 times he went running to Eli, thinking it was Eli calling him. And finally, Eli realized what was happening, and he told Samuel, "Next time you hear God call your name, you answer, 'Here I am, Lord.'" That should be our response to God's call. "Here I am, Lord. Use me. Use me to love that stranger, to feed that hungry neighbor, to care for the earth, stand up for the oppressed and the helpless. But first, we need to listen." How do we hear the word of the Lord these days? The Bible says simply that the word of the Lord came to Jonah. It doesn't say how, but just simply that it came. I've heard the call of God, and I'm sure you probably have too. It is that still small voice that you can hear when you are willing to listen. It may come through Scripture. It may come through nature. It may come through circumstances. It may come through trials. It may come through a friend or a book. God still speaks to us. We just need to listen and then turn around and go where God wants us to go and do what God wants us to do. And summer is the perfect time to listen for God's call. It's a time to get out into nature if it's not too hot. It's time to get near the ocean or some other body of water. God's voice speaks more clearly to me when I am on the water. Summer is a little change of pace, a time to take inventory of our lives, a time to look for those places where we need to repent. May you listen for God's call this summer. I know that's part of what I intend to do on this sabbatical. As you listen for God's call, may you then find ways to heed that calling, and you won't regret it. Jonah didn't regret hearing the call. He regretted refusing to hear the call and refusing to repent. That was the bad choice that had some pretty dire consequences. So listen to God's call on your life, and your story will be epic. And forgive the pun, but yours will be a whale of a story. Amen. Let us continue to worship God as we bring to God our tithes and offerings. The word of the Lord came to Jonah. The word of God comes to you and you and you. How do you hear, where do you hear God's call and God's voice best? Is it in nature? Is it in meditation? Is it in prayer? Is it in reading Scripture? May you find time to listen listen for God's call and then to repent and to follow God's call. And believe me, you won't regret it. Look forward to a little time of fellowship together, some lemonade. We can step outside if it's not too hot, or just stay in the Great Hall and enjoy some fellowship and a refreshing cold drink together. And I'll see you in September, as the old song said. And now receive this benediction. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with each one of you. And all God's people said, amen.